So what I'm looking for here is just kind of a common sense, why is this not correct? Not like, well, this is what you're supposed to do, this is the right answer. Okay. Common sense, why don't you do this? Really, why would you have a common sense intuition about it so that you don't make this mistake, because you understand like what's going on here, what 4, 5, 6 means and what 1, 4 means. All right, so what's a common sense way of explaining why?
It's like saying you're adding 5/6 of an apple to a 1/4 of an orange.
Yeah. Well, it's even more different than I was thinking of using my analogy. So, it's just not just apples and oranges, but 5/6 of an apple to 1/4 of an orange. Which would be difficult to say, like, what that is.
Exactly.
What is that?
It's difficult.
It's 6 of something?
6/10 of. Orange.
Well, what if it was 5/6 of an apple plus 1/4 of an apple?
Then that's 6/10 of an apple.
Is it 6/10?
No.
Is it not?
Sort of.
Why, if not, then why not?
No, I'm just saying. Yeah.
I have my hand up there, but.
You don't have anything new to add?
No.
Okay.
I'm not going to say that.
If it's 5/6 of an orange plus 1/4 of an orange, then. Does it make sense that's 6/10?
No, because those parts are like, you know, well, for that
denominator and all that stuff too.
But also those are different sizes to what the actual 4 is, so it doesn't make any sense why you get, you know, a whole thing out of that if they're like separate sizes.
Okay. So that takes it out of the realm of mysterious unknowable numbers, right? Into what these numbers are actually saying. They're talking about pieces. These pieces are different from each other. Sixths are different from fourths. Okay? And even recognizing that this is how many I have and this is what I have. Like the thing that I have is the significant thing to realize. Okay? So it makes as much sense to add 5 apples and 1 orange and say 6 of oranges. I'm just kind of making up something that they would be. Right? If you don't know what fractions are, you may just add together and get 6/10. But what you should realize is you're just making it up. Just making up that they're tenths. Okay? So just as much as I'm making up a florange, as I'm just making up a new thing for all of them to be, except for they're not actually that thing, like one is apple, or 5 of them are apples, one of them is an orange. And when I put them together and say 6, it's hard to say 6 of what? They're not 6 of any one kind of thing. And with apples and oranges, it's difficult because you can't make an apple and orange, you can't make an orange and apple, and you can't change them both to make them something else, right? We can do that with fractions. This is where we ended last time, talking about how there are different sizes. So we just didn't quite get all the way there, so we started with this question. So in this case, we have 6ths. And we're talking about 5 of those 6ths, right? Everything except for that one. And we're going to add to that 1/4. Okay, there's 4ths, and there's 1 of those 4ths. Okay? So now, just like with apples and oranges, where we can see it's not really 6 of anything, we can see how it's not really 6 of anything, unless we said, like, pieces. We could say it's 6 pieces, right? Could we say that? As much as we could say, like, 6 pieces of fruit. They're both fruits. But then we've lost a lot of information. Okay? And it's still not quite right. Because this piece is not the same as that piece. Right? So somehow we have to make these pieces the same. So if you had a pie that was cut into 6 pieces and a pie that was cut into 4 pieces, how would you make the pieces the same? Yeah, what would you do with the actual pies themselves? You make some more cuts?
You make another cut in 1/4. Make it 6.
Make, excuse me. Oh, just kind of like that?
Yeah.
And like
go.
That?
Now you got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Are these 6ths, though?
No.
No, for them to be six, they would all have to be the same. And when I put six of these same pieces together, I get one whole pi.
Then you gotta mend the pi and then fix it.
I don't think that's gonna work.
Yeah.
But can I make this pi and this pi have the same amount of pieces? That idea is pretty sound. Can I make this pi and this pi have the same total number of pieces? I'm gonna do this pi and then something else to this pi so that they have the same number of total pieces.
Oh, you multiply them again. 6 times 4, 4 times 6.
How do I multiply a sixth by a fourth? I mean, you can do that with fractions and asking what would you do with this pi. How many pieces could I get this to be and then I'd be able to get this pi to be the same number of pieces? How can I cut this in such a way that the pieces are different sizes, right, than they were, but still all of them are the same size as each other? All of these pieces would be the same size as each other. Let's say I cut this one in half. Can I just do that and say now I've divided it so that it's in sevenths?
No, because they're not equal.
No, these are little guys here, right? It would take more of these to make a whole than just seven. Can't just take seven of these and make a whole pie. And if I took seven of these, then I'd have too much. So it's not even sevenths. But can I keep doing that? Like, can I divide this into two pieces? And then what else? Yeah?
Are you trying to get sevenths? I'm trying to get confused.
No, I'm not trying to get sevenths. I'm just trying to get it so that this is cut into a different number than six pieces. Not that all the pieces have to be size. Yeah?
Then cut all the big pieces in half.
Cut all the big pieces in half. Now all the pieces are the same size, right?
Well, there's
so it's
12.
Half as big as it used to be, and now it's in 12 pieces. Right? Does that make sense? Now it's in 12ths. How many 12ths? The whole thing is in 12 12ths. How many 12ths do I have? How many 12ths are shaded in?
Got 10 twelfths.
10 twelfths, because I have 5/6 to start with. Mm-hmm. I cut all those in half. Well, I cut the 5 that I had in half as well. So I have twice as many of those. So I have 10 twelfths. Okay, that'd be great if this was in twelfths, but it's not. Could it be in twelfths?
Yes.
How?
By cutting it the big pieces into thirds.
Cut the big pieces into three pieces each. So 4 pieces. Cut into 3 pieces each. We're at 12?
Mm-hmm.
Twelfths and twelfths. How many twelfths do I have here that are shaded in?
2 twelfths. No, 10 twelfths.
That are shaded in is 10 twelfths. And how many twelfths are shaded in here?
3 twelfths.
3 twelfths. So I have 10 twelfths plus 3 twelfths. And now I can say that I have a bunch of a thing, of a one thing, right? It's not apples and oranges. It's apples and apples, oranges and oranges, twelfths, and some more twelfths. So I have 13 twelfths. Or 1 and 1 twelfth. What can we see here? From this picture and from this little exercise, what can we now see? What truth can we see about adding fractions?
It's pretty simple.
Simple, not quite what I was going for.
It's delicious.
No.
You can't just make a cup of the same size.
Okay.
You have to find, like, you know, kind of a reason. You can't just say, oh, this four is now the same size as the six.
Right.
And that will never happen. It's going to be separate.
Right.
You combine it together.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to happen.
So they're different things no matter how I just try to mush them together. The way that I can make them the same is, but you know, I gotta deal with what they are, what it's saying. I'm saying how big the pieces are, can I make the pieces the same bigness, the same size? I can with fractions. I can't change apples into oranges, but I can turn sixths into twelfths, and I can turn fourths into twelfths, and now I just have a bunch of twelfths. Count them all up, I have 13 of them, 13 twelfths. They have to be the same thing to start with, okay? So if later, I ask you to two x, 1 minus 1 is 0, so 3/2x. But I'm gonna remind you of what fractions are. It's harder to see when it's all x's and stuff, what's going on there, but in general, fractions cannot be added unless they have the same denominator. Why? Because the denominators tell me how big each piece is. Okay? It's hard to explain that here, right? You're trying to add fractions in the wrong way here. It's hard to explain how to add them correctly if you didn't know how to add them correctly back here. And because I see this problem so often, it's a useful thing to say why you need a common denominator, not just to remind you that you need one. Multiply those together. Find the areas of each of these rectangles. Did I have to use this already or not? No. Okay. Like, let's take this for example. Move it over here so we don't have enough room. Okay. Look at 43 times 54. What does it tell me about this rectangle here? Okay. If I multiply 54 by 43, what does it tell me about the rectangle?
It's all of this, like, area.
It's
area, so.
Right? Like, I have 54 little tick marks here, right? And 43 little tick marks there. And so imagine this. At each of these tick marks, I can stack up 43, right? Everybody following along?
Mm-hmm.
You can stack 43. 43 what would these things be? Well, it would be 43 of these little guys. What shape would it be if I drew a little box like that?
Rectangles.
Squares, right? Because they'd be the same. It'd be one by one. Every one of them would be one by one. So I could at every one of these tick marks, I could stack up 43 squares. And I have 54 stacks of 43 squares. And when I take 43 times 54, I'm counting how many I would have if I had 54 43s. I would have that many squares. And if you think about it, that's what area is. How many squares fit? When I find the area, I'm counting up all the little squares that fit in that space. 43 times 54 is the way we usually do that. Okay. So let's multiply this together really quickly, just as a reminder. Right. 4 times 3, 12, and we carry the 1. 4 times 4, 16. Add 1, we get 17. Carry the 1, 4 times 4, 16, add the 1, I get 17. 5 times 3 is 15, but for some reason I write the 5 here instead of there. And I carry the 1, 5 times 4 is 20, add 1, I get 21. 2, this is 12, carry the 1, that's 3, 2,322. So 2,322 squares, I'm sure you can see that really well, would fit inside this box, this rectangle. That's 54 by 43. Right. Now, let's look at this rectangle in a different way. So I just kind of made it bigger. It's 54 on one side, 43 on the other. Okay. So if I do 54 times 43, if I take out my calculator and do 54 times 43, it's like this. We've been double checking our work here. 54 times 43, 2,322 little squares that fit in there. But I don't do that. If I do it by hand, I don't just take out my calculator and multiply them. That's not by hand, right? I do this thing where I multiply the 4 and the 3, then the 4 and the 4, then I come over to the 5, do it by 3, do that by 4. Right? Let's take another look at this rectangle. Break it into a bunch of smaller rectangles. altogether, this is 54. Okay. What I've done, I've broken it apart. So this is 50, and this is 4. This is 40, and this is 3. So how big is this rectangle? What are the dimensions of this rectangle? What's that? 1. It's right below this rectangle, right next to this rectangle. They all came from this rectangle. So what are the sides of this rectangle? What does it look like? Okay. How big is this side? If I were to back it up and put them all back in place, see, they're all back in place there. If I break it off, so this is 4, and this is 3, and this is 40, and this is 50, and it would look like this. Okay. Now change. That's 50, that's 4, that's 40, that's 3. So this would be 3, and this would be what?
4.
Be 4, just as wide as this is, just as tall as this is. Again, this is 50, this is 40. They all just came off of the same rectangle, separated the same way. But if I were to find the area of all of these rectangles and add them together, look at what happens. I do 4 times 3 is 12, right? And then 3 times 5, but not only 3 times 5, 3 times 50, 150. And that 4 times 4, talking about here, we do 4 times 3, then 4 times 4. It's not really 4 times 4. It's 4 times what? 40. You ever thought about that before? When you're doing that 4 times 4, you're not really doing 4 times 4, you're doing 4 times 40. I kind of saw that in a little, it's called stick multiplication. A lot the same thing, isn't it? If I did 4 sticks this way, and 5 this way, and 3 and 4, it would be almost exactly the same. 4 times 40, that's 60. And 40 times 50 is 2,000. When I say 4 times 5 here, or 5 times 4, not really 5 times 4, it's 5 tenths times 4 tenths. What's a 10 times a 10? 100. So when I say 5 times 4 is 20, it's not really 20, it's 20 of 100. That's what this is. 20 of 100. 20 hundredths is 2,000. I add all that together, 2,322 is the total of all the areas of these little rectangles, which is obviously the area of a 54 by 43 rectangle. One thing that I want to use this for today is to talk about why we multiply fractions the way that we do. Okay, shouldn't take too long. Later on, show you why the distributive property works the way the distributive property does. You guys are familiar with the distributive property.
Mm-hmm.
Been dealing with that for a while. So first we have to talk about fractions, but we kind of already talked about fractions. So this 11, tell me what that 11 represents in the number 6 elevenths.
It's the whole thing.
All the pieces combined. Yeah, makes one thing. So 11 pieces makes a whole. So how many pieces make a whole? And 6 represents what?
How many you're calling 1 over.
Right, how many you were talking about? How many we have, we could say. Whether we have them or they're away from us. This is how big they are, this is how many we have. Let me show you 4/5. Looks like this. Right. There's the fifths part of it. It's split into 5. There's 5 pieces making the whole. And if I just look at 4 of them, that's 4/5. Okay. 3/8. I'll cut this into halves and then halves and then halves again. And here are 3 of those, 3/8. So good. Okay. Now you might remember how to multiply fractions together. You might be an expert at doing it, but I wonder, have you ever thought about why it works? And I just multiply straight across. 4 times 3 is 12, and 8 times 5, or 5 times 8 is 40. Okay. But why? Why do we just multiply straight across? It's an awfully convenient, nice thing. Yeah?
Because you multiply, so you multiply straight across. Across, multiply, a common denominator, like something like that. It kind of screws up the whole thing. That's not actually how many pieces. Because that, you just mashed them together still, but you just did it with multiplication instead of adding them. Because you need a common denominator.
So you think I've done it wrong? Well, then you bring up a good point. We need to figure out how many are in the whole, or how many make a whole, okay? And how many do we have, right? And then we'll know. Now, if we remind ourselves of what we've done a few times, we've used rectangles to represent areas, to represent multiplication. The area of a rectangle that has a certain base and height, that area is the product of those two numbers. Okay? So, I'm going to take this 4/5 and this 3/8, arrange them in such a way that I do get a rectangle. I get this rectangle right here. What is this side of the rectangle? How long is it? How long is this side? 3/8. Okay. How long is this whole side right here? 5 what? 5/4. 5 inches.
Yeah, it's 4 inches out of 5.
Could be 4 inches out of 5. We'll say that, like, we've taken an inch and cut it into 5 pieces. Whatever. So if this is like a fifth of an inch, then how long is this? Up to here.
1 inch.
And if this is an eighth of an inch, then how long is this?
1 inch.
So it's to 1 inch by 1 inch. So this is a square that's 1 inch by 1 inch. Okay, so if we're measuring these side lengths in inches, and this is a 1 by 1 rectangle. And the area of something is the number of squares that fit into that thing. If this is 1 by 1, then how many squares fit in here? If this is 1 by 1, how many squares will fit in this 1 by 1? 1. 1 square. It's not 2 by 1, it's not 10 by 5. It's a 1 by 1 square. How many squares fit in 1 square? 1 square will fit in there. Okay? We're trying to figure out this part of the square. Right? How much of the square is it? That's what we're trying to figure out. You see, we have 1 here, and we've got a piece of the 1, which we're probably not surprised that 4/5 times 3/8 is some number that's less than 1. How much of 1 is it? Well, if I take this one thing, this one square, and I cut it into 5 pieces one way, right, and really kind of concern myself with just 4 of those 5. And the other way, I cut it into 8 pieces. Take a second. Well, I've taken a whole thing. I cut it in fifths one way, eighths the other. Right? So, of this whole square, how many of these little guys does it take to make the whole square? Square. How many of these little rectangles here does it take to make the whole square?
4.
How did you know that?
Because I counted them up.
No, we didn't.
All I took 8 by 5. Yeah. Is just easy.
There's like a stack of 8, right? There's 5 stacks of 8. 5 times 8. I have 5 8s or 8 5s, like I can say a row of 5, I have 8 rows of 5, it's the same thing, 8 times 5. So of this square, it takes 40 pieces to make the whole thing. That's what a fraction is. The bottom part is saying how many it takes to make the whole. It takes 40 to make the whole.
Okay.
And how many do we have in here, in this rectangle that we're trying to figure out? Like, what's the area of it? How many of these little rectangles do we have in there?
12.
12, how did you do 12?
It's same thing, three stacks of four.
Three stacks of four, or four stacks of three, four rows of, three rows of four. 3 times 4 is?
12.
How many do we have? 12. We have 12. What do we have 12 of? We have little rectangles, right? Where 40 of these rectangles makes up the whole square.
Good.
Right? So what's 4 fifths times 3 eighths? How big is that inside of that rectangle? It's 12 fortieths of the whole square. And why is it 12 fortieths? Because it takes 40 of them to make the whole thing. Square takes 40 of those little rectangles. And how many do we have? We have 12 of them inside the rectangle. So the area of that rectangle is 12 fortieths, so the area of the big thing is 1. And then the area of that thing is 12 fortieths. And now you can see why multiplying straight across, 4 times 3 is 12, 5 times 8 gives you 40, is correct. Right? Why it is the product of two fractions, the numerator, denominator times denominator. Exactly what it's supposed to count. How many it takes to make the whole, and how many of those things we have. Okay. Pretty cool little use of the area model as well. Let's see why fraction multiplication works the way it works. Does that make sense? Is that new? You seen that before? Finding a common denominator is for adding.
Yeah.
Okay. If you think about it in a common sense way, like when I'm showing it, the reason I find a common denominator is because you add things together to collect them together.
Yeah.
To do that is to say the same thing.
Yeah, I wasn't thinking of area when I said that.
Yeah, it's, you can think of adding as collecting things together like apples or oranges. Multiplication we can think of as area. There's lots of different ways to see them, but in certain ways, when you look at them in certain ways, we can understand all this stuff that we may have not fully understood, like why you need common denominators. Because the denominator is really saying how big a piece of it is, and if I try to add different sized pieces, that doesn't make a lot of sense. For why we multiply straight across, we're just trying to figure out how many are in the whole and how many of them we have, and well, you can see by this picture here, that's exactly what you do. You would just say, it takes 8 to make this whole and 5 to make this whole, so this whole is made of 40 of those pieces. Denominator times denominator. And altogether in our little section here, the area of this little rectangle, we have 12 of those 40ths. Okay. Blank there. What I want to do with you is just a little algebra. So you can get out of the calculator, you can use your paper, but here's what I want you to do. First, pick a number. Okay? Any number, think of a number. You're going to be able to add things to it, multiply it, and divide it off. Okay? You ready? You got your number? Okay? Multiply by 2. No, are you with this?
Nope.
Alright. Multiply a number by 2. Add 10. Got it in your head, that's fine. Multiply by 2, add 10, divide by 2. Subtract the number that you thought of originally. Right. Now you should have 5.
Nope. I don't have 5, so.
Don't have 5?
Until you have.
You should have 5.
My grandpa pulled that trick over.
7. 7 multiplied by 2. Add 10. Divide that by 2. So, this is not 12. Subtract the original number 7. And you get 5.
How about 24?
What about 1,000?
1,000. Times 2.
No, it won't.
Add 10. Divide by 2. Subtract your original number, which was 1,000. 5. Yeah?
How about 24?
How about 24? 24.
Still not good.
Multiply by 2. Add 10. Divide by 2. What did we do there? We divided by 2, subtract the original number, 24, and leaves you with 5.
How about 23.5?
Would also work, but it would be more work to take some use of testing.
Do it.
Yeah.
Let's see.
It's not going to be a thing where I stand up here and do it a bunch of times.
Oh.
How many numbers do we have to do this with to convince ourselves that it works for every number?
Six more times.
Until
you do 25.5.
Until I do 25.5.
Yes, if you do that, then.
25.5 works out nicely because the first thing you do is multiply by 2. This is a 0.5. Multiplying that by 2.
Fine, 25.8.
That's not as nice.
Yeah, that's not good at
you. Just let it go. Well, you're a teacher. You should teach us things how to do it.
He did.
How to multiply that by 2. I think you had to multiply that by 2 if you need to do that.
Sure, what are you doing?
Maybe a one-on-one thing if you can't multiply whatever times 2. Okay. But we'll never do this enough times. I mean, we might believe it. We get 5 so many times that we think it's keep working, right? But if we use algebra, we can see that it will always, always, always come out to be a 5. Right? So what is algebra? Branch of mathematics.
Algebra.
Yes. What is it?
A branch of mathematics.
To represent something usually.
I'm
not using the like x
math.
You usually have x to represent something. So usually you have like 5x, you have 5 or something.
Yes.
That's usually what they use it for.
So yes, letters representing numbers is algebra. It's that simple. You can make that pretty complicated, right? But it's that simple of an idea.
So that's fine.
Because there's a book called The Elements that was made hundreds and hundreds of years ago, where a lot of arithmetic and algebra really was done with line segments. So the length of a line represented the variable, which made it a tricky thing. It was a difficult math. Okay. But the idea of using X, A or B or C or whatever, helped out a lot. So what's the variable in all this, in this whole trick that we're doing? What's the thing that always changes? A person from time to time?
So like personality?
In this trick that we're doing?
The sign.
Sign?
You're basically putting it all in reverse.
No, I'm asking you, what changes from time to time? When I say, okay, let's start the trick, what's different? Yeah, the number that gets picked, whether it's a different person picks a different number or the same person at a different time picks a different number, that's the thing that is the variable, okay? So that's the thing we represent with the letter, okay? So we're representing with X. Why not? Okay. So what was the first step? What's the first thing you do when you pick your number?
How about 5?
It would also
work. I don't wake up. But you minus, oh wait, yeah, it would work.
You multiply by 5.
By 5.
By 2.
Multiply by 2.
Yeah.
Okay. Then what?
You add 10.
Then you add 10.
You divide by 2.
And you divide by 2.
And then you subtract 9 over 5.
So how do we represent subtracting the original term?
X. Subtract.
Subtract X.
You basically go in reverse.
tricky part of it. We do some things, and then we start to take those things away. But the tricky part is really just dividing by 2. First I make you multiply by 2, and then I make you divide by 2. But first, you add 10, right? What's half of 10?
Five.
Whatever you wind up with.
Five. There's part of the secret there.
Okay? When we add fractions together, what do we need? So how about if I take this fraction, which looks like I've added two fractions together, like this fraction plus this fraction. Right? Do these two fractions have a common denominator? Right? And you know, if this was 17, I would do 17 plus 10. If this was 43, I would add 43 plus 10, but then we just say over 2, right? So adding these two together gives you this fraction here. 2x over 2 plus 10 over 2, common denominator, add them together. What's in the numerator? Whatever 2x plus 10 is. Right? And the denominator is 2. Minus x. What's 10 divided by 2? 5. What's 2x divided by 2? 1x. What's x minus x? X minus x? 0. 0. What's 2 minus 2? 7 minus 7?
0.
X minus x? X just represents a number. Any number minus the same number? 0. What are we left with? 5. See, the trick is to build it up and then take it away, but in a slightly tricky way. The trick there is people don't realize that when they divide by 2, they just have x plus their number plus 5. Double the number, then they add double 5, and then they take away 2. You'll always have your number plus 5, and when you take your number away, you'll have 5. What if I had to take away 5 instead of taking away your number? Instead of saying subtract your original number, I said subtract 5. Then what would you have left?
X.
And that was whatever you pick. Okay? Let's try to pick a number. Multiply by 2. Pick a number. Pick a number.
Alright.
Okay. Multiply by 2.
Okay.
Add 10.
Okay.
Divide by 2.
Wait. Divide by 2.
Divide by 2 is where we are right now.
It's always gonna end up.
We're doing something slightly different.
Just a second.
Multiply 2. Add 10. Divide by 2. Subtract 5. Not your original. I'm going to subtract 5. What are you left with?
Wait, hold up. Let's start like the dividing part. I did 5 on the number. Okay, so.
Pick the number, multiply by 2, add a 10.
Okay.
Now you're dividing by 2.
Okay.
And now subtract 5.
Okay.
What do you wind up with? Subtract 5. Don't subtract your original number. Subtract 5.
I did subtract 5.
Did you get your original number?
No, I didn't.
What's your number?
3.
3.
Wait. Like the number that you started out with?
Yeah.
Oh. 6.
You started out with 6?
Yeah.
6 plus 10
over
2 minus 5.
Okay. 16?
No.
Yes.
22.
What?
12 plus 10.
Why did we grab the 2? What's up with the 2?
Multiply your first number by 2.
Well, there's 2 plus. I didn't get that part.
12 plus 10, divided by 2 minus 5, 22, divided by 2 minus 5, 11 minus 5 is 6. The number that you
had is not going to grab that extra 2 there.
Got extra? I said multiply by 2. Whatever, I said multiply by 2 a bunch of times. So these tricks that your grandpa pulls on you or whoever, they become a lot less mystical when you just represent them using algebra. Right? Say, grandpa, all you do is say multiply by 2 and then add 10, but when you say divide by 2, then I have half my original number plus half of 10. That's just, you might as well just said add 5, right?
Mm-hmm.
We just kind of try, that's the trick. We take this make sure you write this down. We're gonna be dealing with numbers in the thousands here. So pick a number, specific number between 2 and 9, including you can pick 2 or 9. Two and nine. Ready?
Yeah.
Good to go. Okay. So a number between 2 and 9, including 2 or 9, you can pick those two. Multiply by 2. Add 5. Multiply that number by 50. Next, if you've already had your birthday this year, add 1,765.
In 2015.
Yeah, in this year, had your birthday this year.
Okay.
So mine is June 5th. I had my birthday already, so I would add 1,065. If you haven't had it, add 1,764.
Wait, how about 1,000? What was the first one?
1,765.
And if you did, that's the one that you did.
Huh?
Yes, you already did. That's
if you already did, have your birthday.
Well, what would if you didn't?
1,764. Just gonna recap here. Number between 2 and 9. Multiply by 2, add 5, multiply by 50, and now you're added 1,765. If you had your birthday, 1,764. If you have not had your birthday. Subtract the year you were born, that four-digit number of the year that you were born.
Subtract that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Alright.
Okay.
Okay.
So now, we should have the number. The first digit is the digit that you picked.
No. No.
Is it actually one of the,
Run through it again real quick. Okay? Pick a number between 2 and 9.
Minute.
You can start over if you want to. Okay? Pick a number between 2 and 9.
That's your gun day. I'll go see it.
Multiply that number by 2.
Can't type this up.
This is starting all over again. Add 5. Multiply. By 50.
Oh, okay, yeah, you're right. All right.
At 1765, if you've had your birthday, 1764, if you have not had your birthday this year, if you've never had your birthday, that's so sad.
Did you make this up yourself, or did you look this up on the internet?
I looked it up.
Okay, that's what I thought.
Then, you're going to subtract your birth year, the year you were born.
Whew.
Now you should have your final number. When you're all done with that, you should have the first digit is your number that you picked in the beginning, and the second two digits are your age.
Okay.
Oh, you're good. You're good. You're good, Gene. 469, I get it. I can go home and juke my parents.
Yes, you could.
Find out how old my dad is. Because he doesn't really tell me anything.
thing we did in the last one.
But
we'll do it out. Taking you right now, right? Start with an algebraic expression. That would be one where you represent the number that you picked by x, or just represent it with x. Okay? And keep in mind at the end you wind up with this first number is your number. And then this two-digit number is your age. That word E, that is the age. So I want you to figure out, using algebraic expression, you can do this over and over and over, specific numbers, it'll keep working. Show what's going on back there. Like, what are they really doing? Obviously, they have to somehow get this number here, and then your age to wind up there. Probably something, like we added something and we subtracted something.
Pattern.
Right? So that's a thing.
Pattern going backwards.
Right? So use that algebraic expression. You can work together, you can work individually. Alright? But in the end, like, probably for homework next time, you're going to turn in something that shows how it is they do these steps and wind up with this number. Follow exactly this. Right? Show the secret behind this seeming magic trick, okay, using algebra. Because otherwise, you're going to have to say, well, this is happening. You can show what's happening when you use algebra. You can use a letter X or A or whatever to represent your number and show what's happening to it. And show, like, oh, they're just taking this number, they're doing this to it. Right? That's how this room is made. Okay? And they're just doing this and that. Why this comes up to be what it is, right? Just show by simplifying that algebraic expression what's going on there. Okay? Alright?
Good.
So that's what I want you to do. Just in on a piece of paper that you will turn into me at some point. And that's what I want you to do. Right here. Right there. Great. Okay? And like, once again, what I'm saying is do something like this. This is a much simpler one, right? You take a number, multiply by 2, add 10, divide by 2. All I'm doing there is I'm canceling out the multiplying by 2, and I'm taking half of 10, which is just 5, right? So I wind up with just x plus 5. And when I take away the number, just leave the 5 that I made.